thank you very much, Roy. What I wanted to talk about today was the relevance, really, of brands and politics. And maybe just to open up by saying it would be impertinent of me to speculate on how any of you may have voted at the last election. I'd be curious to know, but it would be impertinent to ask. But I suspect that many of you might have been attracted to what Tony Blair had on offer in 1997. Not necessarily because you were confirmed Labour voters or you were Tory switchers or whatever, but probably what was on offer in 97 for a whole range of reasons, and I'll come to that, was attractive. It was hopeful. It was about a kind of future in which we could all do well, not because of the family we were born into, but because of our own wits and living in a meritocratic society. And it was a very hopeful place. Indeed, I was then a newly elected Conservative Member of Parliament in 1997, and I was so convinced that 2 years later I joined the Labour Party in Parliament and crossed the floor of the House of Commons. The Labour Party convinced me by argument at that time. Now, in 2010, things have become very, very different. Labour lost the election, and everything I'm going to say over the next 20 minutes is not said as a bad loser. We lost, and arguably, we deserved to lose. We had got into a bad relationship with the public, and I underline the word relationship because I think that's one of the most important things that those of us in politics, arguably anybody in any commercial enterprise too, but certainly in politics, has to recognise. You're in a relationship with the voter. It's not just about a series of announcements and the voter has to take it. The voter actually, at the end of the day, has the final say. And in 2010, they had the final say, and we lost. But the extraordinary thing about the election in 2010 was that whilst Labour lost and most people thought Labour was going to lose, the Tories actually didn't get a majority. And that was extraordinary because everybody thought they would. Everybody thought and had thought for some time that the Labour government was coming to the end of its time. And they were expecting the kind of result that we'd seen in 1979 when there was a sea change, when Margaret Thatcher came in, the kind of result that happened in 1997 when Tony Blair came in. And I think people expected, after three terms of Labour, that there would be a sea change election. It didn't happen. And in a sense, really, I put out at the beginning three questions. The first is, could the Labour brand have been renewed successfully while Labour was in office for that 2010 election? Secondly, why didn't the Tory brand prevail at that election so that they won a majority, not a coalition with another political party, but an outright majority in the way that they had done in 1979, in the way that Blair did in 1997? And the third is about the character of the political brand that will prevail at the next election. Now, as I said, it was a very unusual election in 2010. People expected a sea change. It didn't happen. Inevitably, in a democracy, sooner or later, a government expires. There is a sense that you can do a number of things in office to renew your purpose, your brand, but in the end, people tire of you, they want change, you go, another party comes in. It's worth remarking, therefore, that in the 20th century, that actually meant that the Conservative Party were in office for 2 out of every 3 years of the entire century. There was a Conservative dominance, and one of the questions which is in my mind is, was that really a dominance of Conservative politics in the sense of regression, regressive politics? And in the 21st century, may we now be seeing something which is about progressive politics being the dominant brand characterization ahead of us? But the extraordinary thing about this election, as I say, was that the Tories didn't pull it off. Extraordinary because I think the Tories have been amazing masters of brand management. 1979, look at what Maurice Saatchi, Charles Saatchi, Gordon Rees, Tim Bell put together for a campaign which I think most people would recognise was a transformation of everything that had ever gone before. It was the most extraordinary coordination of communications, clarity, everything that you all recognise in relation to good brand management was what happened in 1979. A simple message communicated extremely effectively. It was repeated in 1983 and in 1987, and to some extent, when we brought Saatchi's back for the 92 election, when I'd left television then and I was then John Major's director of communications, I brought Morris back because it seemed to me that the most convincing thing about the Saatchis was they really understood brand management. They understood the discipline of brand management, and they understood that in a way that even in 1992, an increasingly savvy Labour Party still didn't quite get. But in 1997, the Labour Party had it in spades. And New Labour was, I think, the absolute quintessential example of brand management for that election.